what is the planning and positioning of the various anatomical parts in the following slides. First, we start with the brain. Here the patient, the position is supine and head first, and the NV coil is just used, and these are the protocols we have used in our department. To start with the three-plane localizer and followed by FLAR, SAGE T1, axial T2, all the things are there. This is not the common for all the departments. Each and every department have their own protocols, but this is the protocol in our department. So the image thickness, slice thickness is 5 mm, and the space slicing is it's 1 mm. So here, this way I planned that I took the three-plane localizer axial plane. Actually, I took the axial T2 to see how to demonstrate the planning very clearly. Actually, it should be planned in a three-plane localizer and sagittal sections. It's a parallel to the midline, and it should cover the parietal areas also. And once you plan in the axial plane, you can check with the other two planes like a coronal and sagittal to avoid the obliquity. See, for axial planning, you take a sagittal T1 plot, then you plan like there's a line, you draw a line, that's a line to touch the inferior bar of the genu and the splenium of the corpus callosum. This is axial planes must be parallel to the this line, parallel line. It covers up the base of the skull to the vertex. And similarly, in the coronal plane, it's a parallel to the brainstem and adjusted to the parallel to the very brainstem, and it should be adjusted in the axial section, so that the coronal section is parallel to the line, connecting the both internal canal to the avoid obliquity. This is how you plan for the MREA. So MREAs is normally the 3D tough sequence is used in most of the institutions. It's a 3D sequence. It's almost three blocks are that set. Some overlap will be there in each block. And it should be covered in the entire subclopulous area and should be planned in the sagittal section, then followed by it should be adjusted in the coronal section also. And very important thing is you have to place the saturation band over the planning. This is a scanning area, region of interest, and that this is a saturation band area. This saturation band has to be applied above the region of the interest to avoid the signals from the venous flow. Similarly, MR venogram. This should be planned in the axial plane, and it has to be in a sagittal plane with a 2D top or some piece contrast studies, piece contrast semi or venogram also we can be done. But the planning is the oblique, is the sagittal plane is little oblique. It's angle 10 degree midline to the brain. It's a slight oblique, 10 degree midline to the brain, which reduce the inflow saturation artifacts from the vessels which are seen plane to the normally the transverse sinuses. And a very important thing is that the saturation band has to be placed below the region of interest to avoid the signals from the arterial flow. So in angiogram, it's and that saturation band has to be placed above the region of interest, the planning area. In venogram, it has to be placed below the planning area. The epilepsy protocol, along with the routine sequences, this high resolution 2 mm high resolution T1 T2 oblique coronal plane has to be done for the hippocampus. Take the sagittal T2 image or T1 image, see the hippocampus, identify the hippocampus, then you plan obliquely on the coronal plane in perpendicular to the hippocampus area, and you adjust all the other two planes also to clear the obliquity. And if you want to have volumetric analysis, and then go for a 3D sequence. Or we can be done in the routine NV coil as well as we can bother smaller intraocular lesions with surface coils can be done. And this is a protocol axial T1, T2, coronal T1, T2, and fat suppression has a vital role in this. And if your chances of having the some optionals to see the optic nerves and all, and as well as that if you plan the axial section, they take the paraphase image and see the optic nerve, and it has to be planned parallel to the optic nerve. Similarly, you can plan the coronal plan in the axial T2 image, and plan the, from the tip of the, include the lens to the extent of the brainstem also. It should be perpendicular to the optic nerve. Similarly, oblique sagittal planning can be done for the single orbit. If you want both orbit, you have to plan the separate sequence for the both orbit. Don't plan the same orbit. It will give the base wrapper. Crosstalk artifacts will give them the chiasm area. So protocol for the cell atasia, same in vitro can be used. Sagittal T1, T2, coronal T1, T2, and axial T2 is more than enough. And post contrast study has to be done. If it's a microadenoma, it's a dynamic contrast study has to be done. This is sagittal planning. You take the axial section and plan the mids. Plant the parasagittal section, cover the some parasagittal sections also. Similarly, that's axial. You can plan from the cover the sphenoid sinus and some supracellular extension. If you see the lesion very well, then it covered up to the extension of the lesion. And you take the sag and then you plan the coronal plants that are based with perpendicular to the dorsum of the cell. If the patient comes with blepharospasm or facial spasm or facial palsy, this internal auditory meatus has to be clearly demonstrated to see any pathology in that. So normally the acoustic sonomas may occupy in this internal auditory meatus area. Otherwise some vascular loops also will be seized to overlap with the cranial nerves. The 7th and 8th nerve has to be clearly demonstrated with the help of the fiesta sequences. The fiesta space sequences with a minimum thickness can be, which is useful to demonstrate the IAM. This is the axial planning. You see that on the internal artery canal area, and then you plan accordingly, it's parallel to that. This is the planning for the coronal also. But very thin slices like a fiesta axis are much useful. All the spines have very similar protocols like a sagittal T1, T2, axial T1, T2, and if needed, sag steer and coronal steer or routine sequences, myelobromes are optional. And you plan, it's a coronal steer sequence. Initially, you plan the coronal steer sequences parallel to the spinal cord. And you include the pre-vertebral area as well as some extent to the back to the include the spinous process also. It cover like this. Plan the sagittal T sequence parallel to the spinal cord and in the coronal plane, and it has to be checked with other two planes also. And this is axial planning. Actually, axial planning is routinely it's a body disc, it is more than enough. And additional one to two sections at the level of in place may be useful to see demonstrate the discs. And some injury patients or cord lesions, it's a continuous slices with axial T2 from CV junction to the T1 level. It has to be done without any gap. Lumbar spine planning is so similar to the cervical spine or dorsal spine. First we run with the coronal steer or the myelogram, also useful to plan the sagittal planes. Coronal planes has to plan with in the sagittal T2, sagittal localizer, and it's parallel to the spinal cord. From the coronal steer, the sagittal plan has to be planned parallel to the spinal cord and extend to the parasagittal area also. And axial section similar to the cervical spines, so the body disc is more than enough. Some more sections on the disc levels are much useful to see the disc protrusion and disc bulges. And as well as if you have any lesions or in the the body level, like carry spines or secondaries, then it is continuous slices at stack slices has to be planned for the demonstration of the carry spine and secondaries also. It is better to include the SI joints in the lumbar spines MRI imaging to because sometimes in the SI joints lesions may be caused by low back kick. It's sometimes mistaken as mistakenly referred as MR by MRI lumbar spine only. So it's oblique SI joints are always useful, included to be included with the routine lumbar spine protocol. It has to be planned in the SAG T2 with the oblique, it's parallel to the entire sacrum. In the it should include the entire coccyx also to SI joint. As well as you can, if you want the axial section of SI joint also, you can plan in sagittal plane itself or in coronal plane itself to cover the both SI joints. Dedicated knee coil is used for the knee joint imaging and supine feet first position, and sagittal PD facet, sagittal T2, and if need, sagittal T1 also. Coronal PD facet are still as much useful, and axial PD facet also like it's useful. You plan like this, the axials in the sagittal plane, and sagittal should be planned on the axial PD facet like this, and coronal is also you can plan in the axial, and you can correlate with the sagittal imaging, and it should be parallel to the tibial shaft and the sagittal sections. For anterior cruciate ligament, it has to be planned at 10 degree oblique to the perpendicular to the line connecting the posterior femoral condyle. If you draw a line and at perpendicular to this line, and if you plan like a 10 degree oblique to this perpendicular line, you can get the anterior cruciate ligament very nicely. And similarly, you can plan it the coronal also especially for the anterior. For angle joint, the routine it's a dedicated coils or flex coils or can be used, and feet first position, and use a sagittal localizer and angle the parallel to the distal tibial shaft to cover the from the talonavicular joint at least two slices posterior to the talus. And this is axial planning, it's to cover some extent away from the angle joint, and this is our oblique sagittal planning. You have to plan like a perpendicular, it's a perpendicular to the talar dome. It has to plan like this, not like this. It has to be planned like this, a sagittal imaging. Soto joint also have dedicated coils in the axial sections are planned in the coronal three plane localizers. It cover the EC joint and some extent of the away from the glenohumeral joints. Plan coronal planes obliquely, it's parallel to the supraspinatus tendons, it should be parallel to that, and the saturation bands has to be applied to avoid the artifacts from the breathing. Similarly, it's a sagittal band, it's parallel to the bony glenoid labrum. It has to be planned like this. For elbow coil, it's GP flex coils, and the patient should be in Superman position, flying position. It can be useful, or knee coils can be used for the elbow joints also. The axials and sagittal planes like the plan like this. It should be correlated with the coronal and axial planes, and as well as. And this is the planning for the axial. You plan in coronal, and as well as it is. Axial localizer, you can use it for the coronal planning also. Surface coils or GP flux coils can be used, and in three plane localizer, you can use you can plan the coronal plans parallel to the ulna and radius in axial localizers and to cover the ligaments and on both sides. Similarly, it's axial planning. It's a planned axial section perpendicular to the ulna and radius, and cover the distal end of the ulna and radius to proximal end of the metacarpal bones. And it is sagittal planning, and the plan sagittal plan perpendicular to the axial section in coronal sections. surface coils can be used for the thumb, and this is the planning coronal plane for planning for thumb, and this is axial plan, and this is sagittal plan. You take the axial, and from now we're in the final section of the classes today class. Now we're going to see some of the common artifacts in MRI imaging. MRI artifacts can be classified into four major categories, in which first we're going to look on the patient-related artifact. That is commonly it's a motion or flow-related artifacts. It's called ghost or smearing artifacts caused by the voluntary or involuntary movements that usually occur on the patient cord directions only. This is an example for the piece smearing artifact or ghosting artifact caused by the patient movement. So here the patient cord direction is right or left, and there's artifacts also happen at the right or left directions, and I change the pace direction into superior to inferior, that the artifacts also change into the superior into inferior directions. So the movement artifacts are always happen in pace and code directions. Head nodding and eye movements are some of the movement artifacts. When we going to look on the orbital studies, that it will give a lot of distortion. In such cases, you can use a movement correction sequence called the propeller or blade. And this type of sequences eliminate some amount of the movement artifacts. Swallowing also some kind of movement artifacts that when we do the cervical spine or neck knee imaging, this kind of the movement artifact is seen with the patient is swallowing. So just ask the patient not to swallow and do the fast sequence, that is a remedy for this type of movement artifact. Motion artifact can be it's a reason by the respirations. This kind of the ghosting sort will be seen in the abdominal imaging. For that, you have to apply the respiratory gating, and you will get that this wave format. And this wave format, you can see the white lines. That these lines are synchronized with acquisition. So the particular time the waveform that acquisitions are made, and you can get the clear cut without artifact images with the respiratory gating. Similarly, yes, the ECG gating also can be done with that you can get a similar waveform, and it is synchronized with image acquisition, and this is without gating, and after the ECG gating you can get clear images like this. And the pulsatile flow related artifacts also, it's another type of the movement artifacts. It's caused by the blood flow or CSF flow. For that, saturation bands has to be applied for that. And the CSF flow study, CSF flow artifacts can be eliminated with the help of the 3D cube flash sequence, and you can reformat it, you can completely remove. And the entry slice artifact, inflow artifacts, which has the bright signals in the initial slices of the blood vessels. So this can be eliminated with the help of the pre-saturation bands. If you apply the pre-saturation band completely, that's this end slice artifacts are removed. So another kind of another classification is hardware or zipper related artifacts. And let's see one by one. The zipper artifact is caused by the MRI scan and room, it should keep the door open, or some faulty electric devices from the patients, or inside the room, and some fused bulb inside the room also can cause a zipper type of artifacts. So it is an example for that zipper artifact. So I did the three-plane localizer with the door closed. Nothing is nothing artifact seen. I keep the door open and do the same, repeat the same sequence. The zipper like artifacts are the same. It's an example for the zipper artifacts. Another type of common artifacts is the crosstalk artifact seen in the multi-angle and multi-slice acquisition. And this kind of artifacts are the black bands will be seen the posterior to the spinal cord, where the axial sections are overlapped one and to each other. For that, you have to reduce the angulations, or separately you plan for that, particular slices, and then you'll get the artifact nil image. This cast of artifact also happen in oblique planning of the orbit, and you plan like this, you won't get that artifact. If you plan like a both orbit in a single sequence, then you will get that this type of the artifacts, cast of artifacts over the Kashmir area. This is single site planning, this is a double site planning, you will get this type of artifacts. So another kind of artifacts is called the Moab fringe artifacts, commonly seen in the PSR sequence and the body imaging in grades of path gradient sequences. And the FOV has a vital role. If you increase FOV, you can include some extent above and below, and you can eliminate the artifacts from region of interest. Corduroy, this corduroy artifacts are it's a spike artifacts. It's a more, it's a panel lines, patterns will be seen in the inside the anatomical part, and it's mainly caused by the electromagnetic spikes by the gradient coils and fluctuating power supplies, and sometimes in the faulty coils also cause this type of artifacts. The third classification is inherent and physics and which has the chemical shift artifact and the susceptibility artifacts and magic angle and indirect ink artifacts. So let me see one by one. There are two types of the chemical shift artifacts, and the first kind is the most prominently at the fat water interfaces. Protons in the fat and water process at the different frequencies in applied magnetic field, because the environment of the proton is hydrogen is attached to the carbon in fat, it has six electrons in the orbit. But in water, it is attached to the oxygen, hydrogen, it has eight electrons. Because of the different electron environment, the position is different. So the chemical is different, is the 210 hertz for 1.5 Tesla. So the chemical is different, this is the spatial misregistration of the MRI signal. See the example for the chemical shift artifact. See, this is a kidney area, and then this is surrounded by the fat. So in the image related, it is a misregistration is happened. Because of that, one side overlap is there, another side the signal void is there. So when there is overlap areas, it's a bright signal will be seen, and the signal void areas, a black band will be seen. So in this MR image, you can see that the black band and this side and the white band. This side is a classical example for the chemical shift artifacts. So wherever the object is bounded inside the water conductive object is bounded inside the fat, it will happen. It is always happen in the frequency and code direction. This chemical shift artifact is, depends on the bandwidth. By increasing the bandwidth, we can eliminate the chemical shift. If this is a bandwidth, say in the same sequence repeated, it's two different bandwidths. It's a bandwidth of 15. You can see that the white lines here and the black lines over here. And increase the bandwidth, double that, make the bandwidth into double, you can see that there is no artifact, chemical shift artifact. This black line also very much reduced, but the white line also completely vanished. So when if we don't want the chemical shift of artifact, then you increase the bandwidth, then it will disappear. Indeed, ink artifacts is another kind of the chemical shift artifact caused by because of the fat and water are in phase and certain times, and out of phase is another type and sometimes due to this difference in their positional frequency. So when they are in same direction, signals are added up, and when they are opposing each other, the signals are cancelled each other. This is the diagram. It's showing that sometimes they are in phases, they add up the signal, and after some time, opposing each other, that time the signal void will be seen. So in particular T, that some in phase out phase is happening, and see that is a particular, the T is T is 7, and this is a black boundary is seen in the black boundary artifact, Indian ink artifacts are seen. When the T, there's a T also is very similar, but the T is we make it into 4.2. Inside in 4.2, that's the water and fat is in phase, so it is the block boundary is not same. So this is very much useful to imaging of the in phase out phase imaging of the adrenal glands. So in phase it is very much not seen, and here that out of phase is that adrenal is very much nicely demonstrated. It's the advantage of the in chemical shift artifacts. So another common artifact is magnetic susceptibility artifacts. Is artifacts resulting from the presence of metallic objects, not only disturb the nearby structures but also may result in the signal dropouts, and depending on the sequence used, the long T and the gradient sequences. Remedy for this low magnetic field strength can be used, and 0.35 Tesla, 0.2 Tesla can be used, which has a very minimal susceptibility artifacts, and the matrix size can be increased, and decreasing echo time and increasing the receiver bandwidth also a type of the remedy for this susceptible artifacts. Sometimes mascaras or the eyeliner cause this type of the artifact. These are the kind of the susceptible artifacts. It is with eyeliner. After removal of the eyeliner, it is there is no artifacts. Sometimes iron supplementaries also create this type of the susceptible artifacts. Another artifact is magic angle artifacts. Is seen most frequently in the tendons and ligaments that are oriented in a 55 degree angle to the main magnetic field. This is a classic example for the magic angle artifacts. So that you can see the bright signals in the inferior patellar ligaments, and we measure that it is around the 55 degree. So we suspect it is a magic angle artifacts, and it is the TE for that it is on the magical artifacts very much dependent to the TE. So short TE sequences will show this type of kind of artifacts, and the this gradient as well as T1 also showing the similar signals. Then we preferred a PD fact set, and a PD fact set also, and this some amount of signals are seen, and I prefer the SIR sequence that it shows completely the T is increased up to 50, so it is completely vanished. So if you see any doubtful about the magic angle artifact, then you go with the high T sequence. That will be it will be ruled out whether it is signals or artifacts. The final classification is Fourier transform error, transformation related artifacts or the Gibbs analyzing artifacts. It's the first kind of the Fourier transformation related artifacts. It appears as a periodic ringing at high contrast interfaces. It occurs in the region of boundaries of between the high and low signal intensities, and where that skull bones and brains interfaces or CSF cord interfaces, it will be seen multiple lines along the planes of the interface, and the boundaries it will be seen. By increasing the matrix in this kind of the Gibbs artifacts can be eliminated. You can see the white lines, multiple white lines with minimal so low matrix. It is gradually reduced with by increasing the matrix. When once the 512 matrix is completed, it is vanished. By increasing the matrix, it can be eliminated. So the final artifact is aliasing artifact or wraparound artifact is commonly happen with a small choosing and a small FOV. It's cause this type of artifact, and that is, and that and the region from the outside the FOV is with the wrapper around the back side of the area. This can be removed with the help of the increased FOV, or you can use the surface coils or saturation pulses can be applied to remove the type this kind of the artifacts.